Hello, welcome to self-learning podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on Unit 8, Legislature, and our topic is Rajya Sabha. Rajya Sabha or the Council of States is the upper house of India's bicameral parliament. Three sets of reasons guided the adoption of bicameral legislature for the Union of India. First, Rajya Sabha, as the name implies, was to be the chamber for representing and protecting the rights of the states in the federal polity. Rajya Sabha therefore has equal role and status to that of the Lok Sabha in the electoral college for choosing the president. Members of state legislative assemblies elect Rajya Sabha representatives for their states on a proportional representation system. The constitutional position of the Rajya Sabha is not comparable in power, functions or prestige to the US Senate when conceived of solely in terms of state rights. In the event of a deadlock between the two houses of parliament, for example, if reconsideration of a bill fails to achieve a mutually satisfactory resolution, then the president can convene a joint sitting of both the houses. Its decisions are made by simple majority. Since Lok Sabha MP outnumber their Rajya Sabha counterparts by more than 2:1 in a combined sitting, the Rajya Sabha can generally expect to be defeated. The second purpose of establishing a bicameral legislature was to provide an institutional opportunity for second thoughts and a wiser counsel even after the passage of a bill by the Lok Sabha. This largely depends on the party composition in both the houses. Rajya Sabha's role as critic seemed largely a chimera during the period of Congress party dominance. The third function of Rajya Sabha in the Indian system of governance is to enable a bill to be introduced in the parliament even when the Lok Sabha is not in session. Much of the parliamentary debate and work on the bill can be completed by the time the Lok Sabha reconvenes. In respect of certain specified federal features of the Constitution, the primary amending role has been given to the Rajya Sabha as the custodian of state rights. For example, the powers of Rajya Sabha itself can be altered only with the consent of the two-third majority in the upper house. In theory, the House provides the means to bring in competent or skilled personnel who are not prepared to face the uncertain rigors of political campaigns. They can be appointed to the Rajya Sabha and be inducted into the cabinet without having to go through the formal process of elections. Now let us move to the next point, committees. The Lok Sabha operates with the aid of parliamentary committees. The composition of committees is determined by the speaker and the chief whip with due regard to the respective party's strength in the house. To prevent undue executive influence, no minister who is in charge of a bill being considered by the committee is permitted to participate in the deliberation of that committee. Parliamentary committee helps to explain parliamentary business and to scrutinize the government activities. They may be divided into four broad groups: those that are concerned with the organization and powers of the House, for example, the Rules Committee; those that assist the House their legislative functions, for example, Select Committee; those that assist the House in making government departments more accountable, for example, various standing committees; and those that assist the House in their financial functions, such as Public Accounts Committee, Estimates Committee, etc. Parliamentary committees act as the willingness in the Parliament to ensure culture of accountability and good governance. Financial committee particularly are regarded as the most important one, as they count scams and conventional requires that their recommendations to implemented and to report to the Parliament on the following up actions by the concerned ministers. Now, let us move to the next point, the opposition. The opposition in the parliamentary democracy is expected to play the role of an alternative government. This has not been the case for most of the independent Indian history due to the complete dominance of the Congress party. Because of the multiplicity of political parties in India, the status of the leader of the opposition can be conferred only on the leader of a party with at least 50% in the Lok Sabha. Regardless of the capacity or number to form an alternative government, opposition parties do register and express the delivery of the opinions in a country or as large and varied as India. The opposition also serves as to keep the government on its political toe. The opposition loses when it comes to tally up the votes on any motion, but its statements in Parliament are heard in the country by large and often listened to within the ranks of the political parties. Opposition arrangements therefore often strike a resonance within the party and can shape public policy by this indirect means. The debate that is ostensibly between the government and the opposition can, in effect, serve to structure the internal debate within the ruling party. Jawaharlal Nehru himself was very sensitive to the range of opinion in the ranks of the opposition. This has been a distinctive feature of the Indian politics since independence. Now, let us wind up the session and take rest. Thank you very much for engaging yourself with the self-learning podcasts.